What's going on, guys? My name is Yahya, and this is part 2 of Keras on Android device. In part 1, I showed you how to convert a Keras model into TensorFlow model, and I explained how to do it and why to do it. Now, this video is a continuation to that part, and I'll be doing is I'll be using this TensorFlow converted TensorFlow model on an actual Android application. So I actually developed a few steps here, but I'd like to show it to you in an actual Android Studio application. So the first part is you create a new Android application. Here I'm assuming you know some Android application development. And then first of all, you create this assets folder and you include the machine learning model, the converted TensorFlow machine learning model in as a PB file in the assets, like you can copy paste it. And then you have to include few things in the build Gradle file. Now, not in this project build Gradle file, but in the module build Gradle file. So you have to implement a TensorFlow. So this is right here. So you have to write this line in this part, build.gradle, the modules build Gradle, in the application build Gradle. You have to write this line, which is a TensorFlow. Basically, this is basically written by Google, and this allows you to use TensorFlow models up to 1.13. So if your machine learning model is developed, maybe TensorFlow 2.0, this won't work. So that's why I had to install an older version of TensorFlow to match this version. And to be honest, this is a really stable and tested version of this one. Don't worry about the rest of the stuff. This is just related to my work. Okay. That's the first step. The second step is to declare some variables. So the first variable is the model file. So in this case, I have this assets and I have multiple TensorFlow models. So I need to tell it which model I need to make, which model I need to use to make some prediction, right? So in this case, this model I am using is this one, LSTM blah blah blah, which is one of these four guys, right? And the second variable is the input node. So this input node, the input node represents what? This is the name of your input node. Remember from the previous video, there was like a step where you get the input node and the output node names. What is the name of the input node? What is the name of the output node? That's exactly what you need to put in here. It's very important. So in my case, in the previous video, it was a different input, maybe like a CNN or something, but I developed a different model, and this other developed machine learning model has this input node name, and it has this output node name with the colon and the zero, right? And then I had this input shape. In the other video, the input shape was like 6 points, right? 1 by 6 or 6 by 1. But in this video, this model is developed such that the input is a 3-dimensional, which is 250 by 3, and it's like 3-dimensional, 1 by 250 by 3, right? And then, since we included the TensorFlow in this part in the build Gradle file. And we simply can compile this project or rebuild the project. We can add an instance of this. We can actually use this TensorFlow, right? So in order to do that, we simply write private TensorFlow inference, and then you write any name of a variable, right? Because this variable, that's what we are going to use to load the model and make predictions. Now, this other variable is just an extra part. This is for me because I'm collecting 250 points. So I had to check, did I successfully collect 250 points or not? But usually, to be honest, this is more than enough. These 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines are more than enough. That's why it's included in this documentation, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? And then after you do this, we need to load this model, right? So loading the model is quite simple. We write this private TensorFlow. That's exactly what I mentioned. This is just to make an TensorFlow instance. And then loading the model is done using this technique. You simply use the same name of the variable, which is this variable right here. Maybe you call it X or Y. Just you say equals new TensorFlow inference, and then you write get assets, comma, model file. Note that this model file variable has to match this model file. This is basically where you're basically telling it the path of the TensorFlow model on your Android application, right? And then this get assets will just get This git assets means that it's within the assets folder, right? So that's the first step. You just load the model. In my case, I called it load model. So I made a function here to load this model. I made like a method, load model. So basically you write this line, which is exactly as I mentioned. So this is just loading a model. The second or the last step is to make a prediction. So making prediction is really simple. What you need to follow these four steps. The first step is you use the same variable, which is in this case inference, and you write dot feed, and then you give it with the input. You give it the input node. The input node in this case the name of the input node, which is in this case an LSTM layer, right? The name of the input node was this guy. So you just use this variable right here, and then in the middle here, you're feeding it the data. This is the input data that you, the actual numbers that you want to feed, right? So in my case, these numbers were collected from a sensor, right? That's why I had to collect it, and the project is really huge because of that. And then the last thing is the input shape. This is very important because you need to tell TensorFlow three things: the name of the input node, the data that you need to feed, and what is the shape of this input. Because the thing is, you need to get this data and you need to tell it which node you need to feed this data to, right? Which, because the neural network has like these nodes, and you need, each node has its specific name, so you need to tell which node you need to feed it with this data, right? And the second thing is, what is the input shape of this module, of this machine learning model, so that it can process it correctly. The second step here is you need to run an inference, and you just need to write this line. And here you tell it the output node. The idea is quite simple. After you tell TensorFlow this is your input node name, and this is the data that you need to feed as an input, and this is the input shape, you need to tell it where to get the output, right? Because the output is usually at the last layer, which is at the output node layer, right? That's why you're feeding it with this output node, which has this specific name, right? And after you do this, this is basically get the output node value. In my case, I was doing a regression problem, so the last layer has only one node, and this one node has like some sort of number, right? So I need to get that number. And to do that, I converted this using this part, which is float results, and I just do 0.0f of this fetched data. So you run, this run part is making a prediction, and then this fetch part is to get that result. So what is the predicted output? This is running a prediction, and this is getting the predicted value, right? And obviously this predicted value, I did some sort of casting to get it in a float data type, not a string, not an integer. I want to get the float value of that. And once this is done, I copied this results like array, in the array into this predicted speed variable. And this is very important since I am doing one prediction. I wrote results of index 0, because usually a TensorFlow model is built using tensors, so it's like arrays. That's why you have to consider that there could be multiple outputs, and you need to tell which output you need to obtain. So that's why I wrote results of 0, which is the first output, right? The output of index 0, right? And that's it. You have this predicted output. You can do whatever you want with it. And yeah, that's about it. This if you are doing a regression problem. So regression problem is really straightforward. My prediction function. So in this case, I've done several things, and I eventually followed this technique, and then this predicted speed, I did something with it, okay? Now, if you are not doing a regression problem, if you're doing a classification problem, the output will not be just one node, right? So you will have multiple outputs. So in this case, maybe you have a number of classes, you have 12. So there are two things to worry about. You have to mention the number of classes, and the second thing you have to, in the assets, you have to give a label text file. So in this case, this label, if you click it, you have like from 0 to 11. So I have like 12 labels. These labels could be something else. So why do we do classification? Why do we do regression? Just quickly, regression, if you want the output to be a specific, to be some numbers with fractions, like if you feed 1, the output is 2.3, right? And so on. But classification, if you feed it maybe with like images, the output is maybe a cat, a dog, an elephant, I don't know, a turtle. So in the labels, you can actually write these. You can write these like labels, right? Like cat, dog, you can write all of them. And the idea here is you need to tell it how many classes do you have and what are the classes, and you do that within the label text file. And then the output, you have maybe like 12 nodes, 12 outputs. So each node has a specific value, right? So for example, if, let's say, I'm just gonna open Paint quickly. If you have, three outputs, right? Cat, dog, and elephant. So if this first node has the output of, let's say, you have like the percentage of probability of 0.6, and then this other probability of 0.2, and then this other probability of 0.2. So obviously, the one which with the higher probability, this is basically the most predicted option. So maybe you feed it with the system with a picture, and then it tells you that this picture is a cat with 60% confidence. So this is basically classification. So that's why you have to do more work in classification, such that you need to go through all the nodes to check which one is the biggest, right? So that's why you go through this like output nodes, and then you check which one is the biggest by checking some sort of threshold. So maybe you put this threshold to be if the prediction is with confidence of 0.5, maybe 50% you're confident, then you consider it. If it's less than that, you discard it. Maybe if it says it's maybe like an elephant with 10% like confidence, then obviously this is very low and we can neglect it. So by doing that, you just obtain which node has the highest probability, and then by doing that, you get the index of this node, and then you pass this index here. So maybe index number 5 has the highest probability, so you go to index number 5. In this case, it's number 5, but maybe in your application, this number 5 is an elephant, right? So yeah, that's it about this video. I know this video is kind of like assuming two things, assuming that you know Android development. It assumes that you know about developing machine learning models using Keras, but stay tuned for future videos. I'll be going through a more detailed examples and in depth and in really simple explanation. Now, that's it. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please write down below in the comments. All the information will be in the description section. And yeah, that's it. Thank you guys. See ya.